Unraveled Memorial Christian Church this morning. We are glad that you are joining us in worship on this beautiful morning, a little mild and overcast. We are ready to celebrate our God together this morning. Hear this call to worship. God, you are a God of invitation. You invited Abraham to follow you. You invited the disciples to drop their nets. You invited the children to draw near. You invited Peter to walk on water. You invited the tax collector to dinner. You invited the Samaritan woman into eternal life. Just the same, you invite us to live lives of faith. Give us strength to say yes. Let us worship good and holy God. Love lifted me. Let us lift our voices together.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Holy One, we gather this morning in this your holy creation, and we give you thanks for pulling us through the storms day in and day out, for keeping us safe and watching over us, and for the gift of your blessings. Lord, may we praise you this morning. Amen.
Oh,
continue to pray, as we continue to offer prayers to our God, I'm going to ask you and invite you to pull to your mind, pull to the forefront of your heart, those that need prayer, those in your life who you want to lift up this morning. And I want you to hold those names close to you. There'll be time in the prayer where I will pause. And if you feel comfortable from where you're sitting, or from home, or from your car, say those names aloud. Let them be heard. Because we want to offer those prayers together to our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Be merciful, gracious God, to all. We especially pray this morning for all those that are in trouble. Lord, hear the names of those who are exhausted. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Hear the names of those who are in deep sorrow. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Hear the names of the lives of those that are ebbing away, who are struggling for every breath. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Hear the names of those who are lonely and those without friends. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Hear the names of those who have been forgotten by the world. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Hear the names of those who are sick, who are awaiting tests, who are in transition to the unknown. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Hear the names of those who have gotten a glimpse of life and light, who are rejoicing, who are celebrating the next step, for those who welcome new life. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Ever-loving God, we entrust these names, these people, your creation to you. As we continue to pray the prayer your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We continue our series on unraveling this week. And you'll notice a few different things up at the front this morning. The rains and the storms last night almost pushed us inside, and we had kind of started making those plans last night to be inside the building. We knew we'd, at the very least, probably have a smaller in-person crowd because of the weather today, and so we thought, well, let's just go in, unless the rain is at 0% for in the morning. And I got up this morning, and of course the rain was like at 5 or 10 or less percent, depending on the website you looked at, and I said, you know what? We got to be outside today. There's not going to be any rain. It's going to be one of those coolest days that we have. So here we are. And in part, we got to do a little water walking today. I sort of teased with that on Facebook. If you are a user of Facebook and were able to see that get thrown on yesterday, that we were going to practice a little water walking today. Because of the story we're looking at. And so you'll notice I got my little pool. So get ready. Maybe if you're at home and watching on Facebook or you're listening on the call, you can get your pool out as well or head outside to the pool in your backyard. I don't know what you have. But You have little faith, why do you doubt, right? If you have enough faith, you can walk on water. We're going to remember that story today, and we're going to see just how that works. You'll notice a little bit of artwork. I've mentioned each week we have an artist that's created a painting of a wonderful group of women in Black Mountain. And so you'll notice we've got the artwork for this week up here, in addition to just continuing to weave our lives together symbolically through our weavings that Miss Linda helped us make last week. Last week, as we kind of kicked this series off and got started, I shared with you about how I really believe that Thomas, the one that we love to call Doubting Thomas, that I really believe that he gets a bad rap. I don't think we treat him fair. I think we like to call him that name and we just use it over and over again. And I think doubt is pretty far from what's going on with Thomas, but that rather Thomas is a demander. I shared with you on a prayer call this week about how some of your Bible translations, the one place that you see that word doubt pop up in that story, not even the best translation of that word. So if you missed that, yeah, so that's why you want to join our Monday and Wednesday and Friday prayer calls on our prayer conference call line at noon. We'll continue to think about these things throughout this week. But this week, today, I want to share with you about how I think Peter gets a bad rap. You remember the story that I'm talking about, right? I've got the pool out this morning. I've already mentioned the water and the walking. This great story of Peter and Jesus and the disciples. And I want to remind you of that trouble, or that story that is full of trouble that Peter gets into. But it's from Matthew chapter 14, and it starts around verse 22. So if you want to read along with me, you're welcome to. Right then, the story says, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead to the other side of the lake while he dismissed the crowds. And when he sent them away, he went up onto a mountain by himself to pray. Well, evening came, and Jesus was alone. Meanwhile, the boat, fighting a strong headwind, was being battered by the waves and was already far away from the land. Now, very early in the morning, Jesus came to his disciples, walking across the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on that lake, they were terrified. And they said, "It's a ghost!" You can imagine, right? Storms, the winds are blowing, the storms, probably early in the morning, probably can't see well, maybe overcast like today, right? It's a ghost. They were so frightened and they screamed, the story says. Just then, Jesus spoke to them. "Be encouraged. It's me. Don't be afraid." Some translations will say peace, right? Peter replied, "Lord, if it's you, come to me on the water. If it's you, order me to come to you on the water." And Jesus said, "Come." So then Peter got out of the boat and was walking on the water toward Jesus. But when Peter saw that strong wind, he became frightened and he began to sink. And he shouted, "Lord, rescue me!" Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him, saying, "Oh, you man of little faith, why did you begin to have doubts?" When they got in the boat, the wind settled down. Then those in the boat worshiped Jesus and said, "You must be the Son of God." Now, there's the story. You've been around church any time. You've probably heard some teaching or preaching or explanation of this story. And the typical take of this story kind of goes like this. Peter sinks in that water after he steps out onto the lake because he doubts. Because he takes his eyes off of Jesus for the slightest moment, right? Peter sinks because he doesn't have enough faith. And if he had had enough faith, if he had kept his eyes fixed on Jesus, if he had not doubted, then he could have made it all the way to Jesus across that water. Peter could have walked on water. Peter could have made it, and you can too if you just have enough faith. Pastors preach this story as if the only thing that you need to do in life is have more faith. And if you do, you can do anything. There's some amens going on somewhere. You want to be an astronaut? Have more faith. You want to solve world hunger? Have more faith. You want your mother to be healed from cancer? Have more faith. You want to rid yourself of addiction? Have more faith. You want to pass that math class that you're getting ready to start and it's going to be hard and you're going to struggle with? Then just have more faith. You want to lose weight? Have more faith. You want to get to Jesus across that lake of water, that divide that seems to be separating you from him? Then just have more faith and get out and walk and you'll get there. You want anything? Have more faith. Have more faith becomes the answer to every problem. And there is some truth to that. We need faith. We desire deeper faith, stronger faith, bolder faith, wiser faith, more faithful faith. I mean, I don't know about you, but I certainly desire those things. I want those things. I want to grow in my own walk with Christ, with God, my own spirituality, and deepen my faith. I want all those things. So I thought this morning that we could just test it out for a minute. I thought I'd bring my pool out. It's not mine, actually. The Corrals let me borrow theirs. And I thought that just for a moment we could kind of see if or how this works, maybe kind of understand a little bit of what Peter was going through on that day, try to get a little sense of this water walking thing. So I thought, you know, if Peter can do it, you and I can do it. And if we just have enough faith, then we'll be able to walk right across this pool, right? That's the way it works. So a simple story, simple moral. I've heard it preached, I don't know, dozens and dozens of times in my life. So I thought I should be able to do this morning. I hope I rolled my, you know what, I'm not sure I did. I think I need to go one more roll here. Well, how about this? How about we just hike them up this way? That'll work. I can have enough faith that my pants won't get wet too, right? So I just thought we'd see. So if I have enough faith, according to the story, right, then when I step in here, I can walk right across this water. All right, let's just test this out here. Now I feel like I'm a pretty bold man of faith. Somehow, for some reason, I keep falling into the bottom of the water. I don't know if y'all can see it, but I keep falling down to the bottom of this pool. I mean, I'll tell you what. It causes me to wonder that if simply having more faith is the only answer to the things that we go through in life, to the things that we struggle with, to the tasks that we're trying to do, to the healing that we need in our lives. Now, I'm not trying to downplay this, and there's a lot of pastors on here right now probably thinking, y'all need to fire this guy right now. Hear me out. Hear me out. I mean, if Peter, that great rock upon which Jesus built his beloved community called the church, if he didn't have enough faith to get across that lake to get to Jesus, then I don't know about you, but I don't think I can even get across that pool. Have more faith, Pastor, and you'll be able to walk across that water. Okay. I want you to come out and try it. I challenge anyone in the city of Dunn right now to come and walk across the top of that water in the pool. Have enough faith, and you can do it. Hopefully, you can start to see where I'm going with this. Trite answers to the deep concerns and problems and struggles of life may sound good on the surface, but there's more to life than sometimes the trite and cliche answers that pastors want to throw at you. Faith is vitally important. But I think that we take this story about Peter and we make it about the amount of faith that Peter has, big or little. The amount of faith that we have. Strong enough, weak enough, just have more faith. Anything can happen. Have more faith, go home, sit down, it'll happen. God will do it in your life, right? Sit back and wait for God to do it. We hear Jesus' words in this story, right? You of little faith, why did you doubt? That's what Jesus says, what we just read a little few minutes ago. And we think, we hear this as a reprimand from Jesus. As a reprimand from Jesus to Peter, the rock upon which Jesus was going to build his church. Well, first of all, if you'll look with me deeper into this particular scripture, and if we go back and we look at that English word doubt that you hear over and over again as you've read this story throughout your life, and if you go back to the original language that it was written in, that good old Greek of the New Testament, and you look at the word that is written here, you will find that it's not about doubt. It's a translation that I shared with you in the Thomas story that's a poor translation of a word that means unbelief and uncertainty, but some English folks like to put doubt in that place. Doubt, I've told you over and over again, I've shared with you my conviction that doubt is not the opposite of faith, but that doubt is the journey to deeper faith. And I think that's also what's going on in this story today, as a matter of fact. But the word that we see here in the Greek language is about wavering. Hesitating. It's about having two directions and not being sure which one you're ready to set out on. It's about being indecisive, unsure. I think a better translation, if we look at that original language of Scripture, the words of Jesus are more accurately, "Oh, you of little faith. Why did you hesitate? Why did you waver?" When Jesus mentions little faith, his point is not about believing more or stronger or bolder. His point is about acting. Why did you hesitate? Go ahead and take that step. Don't be divided at the crossroads. Get out of that boat and start walking. Don't stop, keep on moving. And this makes all the difference in the story that we're reading today. The story isn't about simply having more faith and you can walk across the water. The story is about taking certain action through your faith. Peter stepped out of that boat in the midst of the battering waves and stormy winds. And this figure who everyone thought was a ghost that was in the boat, right? You remember the disciples said, "Oh, it's a ghost." Scared them. And things for Peter started to unravel in that moment. His faith led him off that boat, right onto the water. He believed. He wouldn't have taken the step of faith into the water if he hadn't believed. His faith gave him the strength to take that first step. And he took that initial action because he had that deep faith and that deep love for God. However big or little, we can describe that faith in terms of, praise God for Peter. Because I'm not sure that you or I would do the same thing even if Jesus was calling me off the boat right now. But like every step of faith that we take in our lives, the world around Peter and the world around us so often and so easily begins to unravel. The trials hit us. The storm threatens us and Peter alike. The walls rise around us. The barriers get thrown at us. The hurdles are set before us. The obstacles confront us. The naysayers begin to doubt us. The tides rise against us, just like they rose against Peter that day when he stepped out of the boat and his world began to unravel. And for the moment, however brief, he began to hesitate. He stopped moving forward. He hesitated and he began to sink. He wavered. He was uncertain when all of that situation and all around him in that story began to unravel. He was uncertain whether it was Jesus or whether it was a ghost, perhaps. He wavered when he saw the waves and the storm approaching him that were already beating against the boat. And for however long, short, I don't know how long it was. It could have been minutes. It could have been dozens of minutes for all we know. But Peter was uncertain. He wavered. And don't act like you and I don't do the very same thing when we set off into those things that we feel committed to and convicted of in life. Don't act like we don't hesitate. We all hesitate. But there's a good word in this story, some good news in this story, because you see, the world will unravel around us. You can be sure of it. That's what the story reminds us of. Go ahead and take that step of faith, but know for certain that things will come undone as soon as you take that step of faith. The world will throw some stuff at you. People will throw some stuff at you, and you will start to wonder. You will start to waver. You will start to hesitate. It's the truth. It's the way the story goes. And if it happened to Peter, the person on whom Jesus built the church, surely it's going to happen to you and me. But look at what Peter does in the story. Right? Look at what Peter does. He calls out to Jesus, "Lord, save me! Lord, save me!" And what happens? Jesus walks right on over to Peter across that water and reaches down into that water and pulls him up. Jesus, when we step into the water, however bold we are to take that first step, and we sink, Jesus reaches right down into that water and picks us up and pulls us out. That's the message. That's the story. That's the beauty of this story in Scripture. We love to pare it down to just have more faith and you can walk across water. Brothers and sisters, try this. Have faith and step out into the things that God is calling you to. Step out into this world and the things that you're committed to through faith, knowing that when the world unravels around you, you can call out and your Lord and Savior is going to reach down and pick you up and get you right back to where you need to be. I don't think this is a story whose moral is to simply have more faith at all. This is a story about how Jesus saves us when the world around us comes undone, when the storms rise and the waves beat against the boat. Be bold enough, the story says, like Peter, and step out. But know that the world is going to beat you down and you're going to start to sink, but that there is a Savior to pick you up. Listen to the way a few biblical scholars say it. Walter Brueggemann and some others. This is not the story of a skeptic who habitually doubts. As I shared with you, doubt isn't even the best translation in the story. Hesitate. But this is the story of the faithful follower who becomes overwhelmed by the circumstances surrounding him, who begins to lose his nerve when he discovers the odds stacked against him, but who from Jesus finds a steadying and delivering hand. A steadying and delivering hand. That's the moral of the story. A story that reminds us, no matter how little faith we all may have, Jesus is drawing close to you to reach down and pick you up out of the muck and the mire of life. Brothers and sisters, that's good news. Here's the thing. I don't know of a place in Scripture where it says you have to be the one to get across the lake towards Jesus. There's this thing called grace in Scripture, right? This says no matter where you are in life, no matter how much you're sinking, Jesus will come to you and rescue, right? So why is it that we take the story of rescue and try to turn it into something that you have to do in order to get across that lake all the way to Jesus? We don't even realize that we're doing it. Pastors don't even realize that they're taking grace out of the story when they say to you, have more faith and you'll walk across that water. Simply have more faith. No. Have faith and take that step. Take that action knowing that the world is going to come, that you will waver. It's a part of your humanity. We will waver. We will hesitate. But if you will take that step in faith and allow yourself to be rescued, you can be certain that you'll find Jesus is right there to pick you up, that Jesus is right there beside you. And you just may find that at the end of the day, just like those disciples who were sitting in that boat, that you're looking around at yourselves amazed, utterly amazed, saying, truly, this is God's Son. Amen. We want to invite you this morning, as we do every week, to prepare your communion, your hearts, and your minds to receive the holy meal this morning. The blood and the bread of Jesus, who himself hung upon that cross, who himself called out to God, why have you forsaken me? Save me, right? And God, of course, reached down. Into death, God reached down and pulled Jesus up. Just like Jesus in this story pulled Peter up. God reaches down and pulls Jesus up through resurrection into eternal life. A story that you and I are invited to remember and to partake in as we receive bread and juice this morning. Hopefully, if you're at home, you've grabbed your bread and your juice, and I want to invite you to take that bread right now. Remembering that long ago, Christ sat in an upper room with his disciples and took a loaf of bread and broke it. A symbol that we're all broken and going to be broken, that we're going to waver and hesitate. That life will come undone around us just as the bread came undone when he broke it in that room that night. You can be certain of it. But Jesus said, whenever you break this bread, whenever you're broken, whenever life comes undone, remember that I'm here. Call out, and you'll be rescued. We remember today as we eat the bread together.
We come to the table each week to remember, and we do so because we have faith. And we do so because through our faith, we know that we need to keep joining our hearts around that table. We need to keep remembering. We need to keep our eyes on Christ. That we need that relationship, and we need to reach out sometimes ourselves. We remember all these things as we come to the table together, as we share in the cup. That Christ said, whenever you drink from this cup, do so and remember me. So we come to the cup with faith, remembering that Jesus poured out his life for us. Let us drink together. Will you sing with us this morning our song that we have learned to go with this series of Unraveled? Weave us together. together. We must together, together in love. We are many textures, we are many colors, each one different from the other. But we are entwined with one another in one great tapestry. You would weave us together. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, you've noticed that our tapestries this week, up at the front, they've grown just a little bit from last week, and they'll continue to grow each week as we are reminded through the stories that we share together each Sunday morning, that it's Christ which reaches down into the unraveling of our lives and weaves together something beautiful. Last week we saw that through Thomas. This week we see that again through Peter, through how Jesus saves us even when we hesitate and when we waver and when we falter. Don't let anyone tell you that the only simplistic little answer to all of life's problems is to have more faith. Yes, it's important to grow, to cultivate, to deepen, to strengthen, to bolden our faith. But what the story of Peter tells us is to take a step of faith, knowing that when it comes undone, God is right there to weave you back together again. We invite you to leave from this place this week. Don't forget our Monday, Wednesday, Friday prayer calls each week at noon. We hope that you'll join us on our conference call line. All that information's on our website. You can find it there. We were able to deliver some hygiene kits. Joni took those up to Raleigh this week, and they're getting all around the state. So if you didn't get that word, we want to thank everyone who made one of those hygiene kits. These are kits that go and help with those natural disasters that happen around our communities, hurricanes and storms and otherwise. So they're getting all around North Carolina and other places through Church World Service, probably as we speak. Thank you so much for taking the time to make some of those. We do want to make you aware to watch your email, Facebook, and your phone messages this week. We have been planning with the city of Dunn, to help the city host a movie night. And so the plans are through the city, and I'm always waiting on final words and everything, but that we'll be in Tart Park on Friday evening with our big movie screen set up. The city's hosting it. They've got a couple of food trucks that they have secured to be there. So it'll be a fun evening, hopefully a cool evening like today. But we would love for you to come and join us out. I think we're going to watch Doolittle is the plan. That's the last word I got. I got to verify all that this week. But watch your email and plan on that. We'd love to see you out there, socially distant and masked and all of that good stuff. But nonetheless, together as a community, as we can enjoy an evening of fellowship and fun together. Are there some other things that I'm missing, Johnny?
Yes, two things coming up also this evening. Just to remind everyone, we'll be in our sanctuary at 5 o'clock for a time of meditation and reflection. We do ask everyone to wear masks, and we'll ask families to sit 6 feet apart just so we're safe and keeping everyone healthy as we do so. But we will be in the sanctuary. Colton will be playing some organ music, and we are excited to be able to join in that space together. And then also want everyone to go ahead and mark your calendars and invite folks to help us. We need volunteers on Tuesday, August 25th. That is our day to help secure volunteers for the Duma Food Pantry. So if you are available anytime between 9 a.m. and 2 p.m. that day, we do need some help volunteering and serving food to our neighbors that come out on the 25th of August.
Yeah, just a little over a week away, and that's all on us. So we'll need lots of help. We need to have about 20 people out there for that service.
And one other thing I just thought of, be looking for your email this week and other forms of communication. We will send out our prayer list for our students and teachers, many of who are starting school this week, some tomorrow. So just be looking for that. We are getting all those names together and making sure we have the most accurate list, but look for that, because we do want to be praying for our students and our teachers and faculty members in all levels of education this week.
Want to encourage you lastly to watch our church blog at our church website. If you're on Facebook and you're watching now, please make sure that you just like the service so that we know that you attended on Facebook this morning. If you're on the conference call, we're so glad that you are with us this morning. We will have, if you aren't able to see it right now, because maybe you're on our conference call line, we will have the piece of art that has been created for this week's story, Peter and the Walking on Water story. We'll have it in the sanctuary tonight for our time of reflection. If you'd like to come and use that as part of your prayer and meditation this evening, you're welcome to come. But we'll also keep this in the main entrance after tonight. So if you'd just like to come by and stop in, pop in the church door one day this week and take a few moments to gaze at it, we'll send it to you in a digital form over your email as well. But we really want to encourage you to use the artwork each week as a part of your prayer life, your prayer time, and your reflection as you continue to consider God's word through the stories that we're sharing. Let us join hands as we sing our closing song, We Are Family Together. Reach out your hands. We're not going to join hands yet, but we are going to reach out symbolically to one another and to God as we sing together.
We are a family. Salt of the earth, light of the world, servants of love.
Goodbye and God bless.
Go in peace.